St. Jacob Lutheran Church. My name is Pastor Kurt Buehlerbrock. This is our online service for the sixth Sunday of the Trinity for July 19th, 2020. Today our focus is on faithful commitment, or being faithfully committed to our Lord Jesus Christ, our confession, and what we say, and honoring that commitment. We begin by singing our opening hymn, "Your Hand, O Lord, in Days of Old," 520, in 520. You are the giver of all that is good. Help us love you with all our heart. Strengthen us in true faith. Provide us with all we need. And keep us safe in your care. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Second lesson for this, the sixth Sunday after Trinity, is recorded in Romans chapter 3, reading verses 3 through 11. Or do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him by this baptism into his death, so that just as he was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too would walk in a new life. For if we have been united with him in the likeness of his death, we will certainly also be united with him in the likeness of his resurrection. We know that our old self was crucified with him to make our sinful body powerless, so that we would not continue to serve sin. For the person who has died has been declared free from sin, and since we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that since Christ has been raised from the dead, he will never die again. Death no longer has control over him. For the death he died to sin once and for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, also consider yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the Epistle of our Lord. Alleluia, happy are they who hear the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart, and bring forth fruit with patience. Alleluia. Holy Gospel is recorded in Matthew chapter 5, reading verses 20 through 26. Indeed, I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and experts in the law, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. You have heard it was said to people long ago, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you that everyone who is angry with his brother without a cause will be subject to judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raca, will have to answer to the Sanhedrin. But whoever says, you fool, will be in danger of hellfire. So if you are about to offer your gift at the altar, and there you remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, then come and offer your gift. If someone accuses you, reach an agreement with him quickly while you are with him on the way. Otherwise, your accuser may bring you to the judge, and the judge may hand you over to the officer, and you will be thrown into prison. Amen, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. This is the Gospel of our Lord. We continue by singing the Ten Commandments Are the Law. That's hymn 285. We'll sing stanzas 1 and 2, and then 6 and 12. 1 and 2, 6 and 12.
Thank you.
peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to whom we make a faithful commitment. Our text for today is from Ruth chapter 1, reading verses 1 through 17. During the days of the judges, a famine occurred in the land, so a man left Bethlehem in Judah to stay a while in the territory of Moab. He, his wife, and his two sons. The man's name was Elimelech. His wife's name was Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were from the clan of Ephrath, from Bethlehem in Judea. They entered the territory of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, so she was left with her two sons. Then they married Moabite wives. The name of the first was Orpah, and the second name of the second was Ruth. They lived there for about 10 years. But Naomi's sons, Mahlon and Chilion, also died. So the woman was left without her two children and without her husband. Then Naomi set out with her two daughters-in-law to return from the territory of Moab, because while she was in the territory of Moab, she had heard that the Lord had graciously visited his people by providing them with food. So she left the place where she had been, and her two daughters-in-law left with her. They set out on the road to return to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back, both of you, return to your mother's house. May the Lord show you kindness as you have shown kindness to the dead and to me. May the Lord grant that each of you find security in the house of a husband." Then she kissed them, and they wept loudly. But they said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people." Then Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why should you go with me? Am I going to give birth to any more sons who could become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go, for I am too old to be married to another husband. Suppose I say I have hope and I will be married to another husband tonight, and I will even give birth to sons. Would you wait for them until they grow up? On the basis of that hope, would you give up the chance to marry another husband? No, my daughters, this is much more bitter for me than for you, because the hand of the Lord has reached out against me." They once again wept loudly. Then Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth would not let her go. Naomi said, "Look, your sister-in-law has returned to her people and to her gods. Go back, follow your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not urge me to abandon you or turn back from following you, because wherever you go, I will go, and wherever you make your home, I will make my home. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me severely and double it if anything but death separates me from you. Mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you." Jude 2. Dear friends in Christ, this was a very busy week. Since our annual meeting was scheduled this week, it meant that the fourth quarter report needed to be prepared, and also the annual report. In addition to the weekly sermon that needs to be prepared, I participated in a few meetings. So I have some very shocking news. I didn't have time to prepare a message for today. Well, that statement isn't quite accurate. The time didn't allow me to prepare a sermon this week. It was only a ploy to make a point. But the Lord and this congregation have a right to expect His commitment to faithfulness, to prepare a worship service and usually a sermon once every week. What I told you may have sounded like flimsy excuses. I could appeal to your sentiments and reasons, but that would not excuse my responsibility. Many of you are employed, and your employer expects that you show up on time and carry out the duties required of you. But what if you are tired, or it's just too cold or hot, or you just don't have the patience to cope with people who are scared, upset, or irritable, possibly because of all the adjustments to our normal way of life because of the coronavirus? But we have responsibilities. God also expects His children to be faithful followers. He wants His people to be faithful in living their Christian lives. Many passages in Scripture talk about commitment to faithfulness, but maybe none more so than the true story, or better, account of Naomi and Ruth. The account of Naomi and Ruth resonates a commitment to faithfulness. May we join Ruth in such faithful devotion to the Lord Jesus and declare, "Your God will be my God. Where you go, I will go. Where you die, I will die." Because Your God will be my God. I will go where you go. Do you know the story of Ruth? If not, listen to this. According to the first verse, Naomi and Ruth lived in the days of the judges, after Joshua and before Samuel. Because of a famine in Judah, a man from Bethlehem named Elimelech left the country of Israel to live as a foreigner in Moab for a while. But the Hebrew indicates that he fully expected to return. His wife's name was Naomi, and they were from the clan of Ephrathah from Bethlehem in Judah. They had two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, and they lived in the territory of Moab for a while. Elimelech died and left Naomi, a widow, with two unmarried boys. Then the two sons filled the emptiness in their lives after some time by marrying Moabite women named Orpah and Ruth. While the law of Moses ordered Israelites not to marry Canaanites or foreign spouses because he wanted them to maintain their commitment to the Lord and to their marriage, and their marriage would be endangered, the Moabites were cousins to the Israelites through Lot, Abraham's nephew. The five of them lived in Moab for about 10 years. The marriages may have occurred near the end of the 10-year sojourn because neither son had any children. Though not impossible, it would have been unusual for both women to be barren. Naomi's two sons, Mahlon, who was married to Ruth, and Chilion also died, but we aren't told how. In the scriptures, names usually have significance. Elimelech means God is king. In the book of Judges, an often repeated phrase states, in those days Israel had no king. It is refreshing to see that at least one family in Bethlehem acknowledged the fact that Israel did have a king, the Lord. Bethlehem originates from two Hebrew words, Beit and Lechem, meaning house and then bread. So it is ironic in a town called House of Bread that there was a famine. Naomi's name means pleasant without the ending I. With the suffix I, her name means either my pleasant or she who is pleasant. The two sons have rhyming names, Mahlon and Chilion, and maybe these are nicknames given by the family in place of the names given at birth. Orpah and Ruth were Moabites, and not much is known about the Moabite dialect, although the name Ruth does sound a lot like the Hebrew word for friendship. Good news came to Naomi. When she was in the territory of Moab, she had heard that the Lord had now provided food for his people back in her hometown of Bethlehem. So Naomi left her temporary home in Moab and prepared to return home to Bethlehem, and her two daughters-in-law accompanied her. They set out on the road to return to Judah. In Mideastern countries, it is rare that goodbyes are said in the home. So it is quite natural and good manners required that the person who is leaving is giving company for a while as they walked along the road. When courtesy had served its purpose, Naomi tried to make it clear that to her two daughters-in-law that she wanted them to return home alone, that she wanted to return home alone. She was thinking of their best interests as women. Marriage was about the only occupation available to women in those days, and Naomi knew there was little likelihood of a foreigner finding a husband in Bethlehem. The better choice would be return to their childhood home. Go back. Both of you return to your mother's house. Naomi had two wishes for her daughters-in-law. Both of them were made in the Lord's name. First, they would remain faithful to the love of the Lord in recognition how they had themselves had proven devoted and loyal in their love for their dead husbands. Naomi says to her two daughters-in-law, may the Lord show you kindness as you have shown to the dead and to me. Possibly this shows that both women had been touched in their marriages by the faith of the family into which they had married. Second, Naomi wished them the security that a new marriage would provide. Then Naomi said, may the Lord grant that each of you find security in the house of a husband. Naomi gave each woman a kiss of genuine affection. Tears flowed profusely. Orpah and Ruth both insisted that they had that they joined Naomi on the road for more than just good hospitality. They intended to walk the whole journey back to Jerusalem, or back to Bethlehem with her. But parting is such sweet sorrow. The women wept aloud and insisted that they would go with her. Naomi asked, "Why would you go with me?" She mentions that she isn't pregnant and wouldn't expect Orpah and Ruth to wait for her future sons if she was. Naomi was referring to the Levirate law, which said that a brother would fulfill the marital duty to produce a son. The Lord instituted this law to protect and guarantee the continuance of the family line. As young widows without children, the daughters-in-law would be without good prospects for marriage in Judah. While being courteous, Naomi took a firmer tone with her daughters-in-law. She wanted them to set sentiments aside and be sensible about their situation and hers. Two realities stood behind Naomi's reasoning. First, marriage is what they needed. Second, marriage in Bethlehem would be almost impossible for foreigners. Assuming the three of them would settle in Bethlehem, Naomi saw herself as the only one who loved them enough to offer them marriage partners. Furthermore, Naomi herself was not married. She was past the age when women conceived. Even if she would remarry and give birth to two sons, it would take them years for them to grow up. Would these two daughters-in-law give up the chance to marry another husband? Naomi concluded with a soft but firm no. For them, remaining in Moab was much better. Naomi compared her plight with that of her daughters and stated, "It is much more bitter for me than for you, because of the hand of the Lord has reached out against me." Being alone in a strange land without family was something Naomi had experienced. It was not pleasant and made the quality of her life bitter. Naomi's words convinced Orpah. They all shed more tears. There was a final affectionate kiss, and they parted. Orpah left, wishing to be a wife again. Ruth stayed, content to remain a daughter. She clung to her mother-in-law. The verb clung here is one that communicates the strongest and tenderest emotions, as it does in Proverbs. A man of many acquaintances may suffer harm, but there is a loving friend who sticks closer than a brother. Naomi further encouraged Ruth to follow Orpah. "Go back and follow your sister-in-law. To her, Ruth's place was with her people, her family, and her gods. But Ruth replied, "Do not urge me to abandon you or turn back from following you, because wherever you go, I will go, and wherever you make your home, I will make your home. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God." For Ruth, leaving Naomi was impossible. She was no longer a Moabite at heart, nor a worshiper of Chemosh, the god of Moab. She believed in the Lord God. Naomi was the only one of God's people she knew. Ruth leaned not only on her affection to Naomi, but gave her heart to the Lord. She would cling to Naomi and God's people for the rest of her life. Is that the same type of spiritual faithfulness you demonstrate? Are you waiting for a deathbed to confession to really serve your Lord? Do you see a great need to make a faithful effort every day to hear or read God's word? The faithfulness of church members in our nation is very low. How many of the members at St. Jacob attend Bible study? How many read a daily devotion? What do you say to God when you fail to worship Him? The Lord expects complete faithfulness to His word. Does your faith in the Lord God mean that much to you? Would you be willing to say to your parents, your family, your church, your Lord, "Your God will be my God"? If you are a communion member of this church, you did that when you were confirmed. Would you still hold to that confession, "Your God will be my God"? Would you say in the midst of persecution, addiction, or family conflict, would you say it to a Christian spouse, "Your God will be my God, and where you go, I will go"? Such faithfulness to the Lord and to his spouse often makes Ruth's words a favorite marriage text. While this is strictly not a marriage text because the people here are not marriage partners, the thoughts of faithfulness and commitment are certainly here. Spouses are expected to remain faithful to their marriage vows and to the Lord. This text confidently proclaims the commitment to remain faithful to the Lord. Sadly, the opposite often happens in mixed marriages, but God desires for the husband and wife to faithfully commit to these statements: your God will be my God, and where you go, I will go. Because your God will be my God, Ruth declares, where you die, I will die. People sacrifice a lot for each other, especially family. But what about death? Paul wrote in Romans, very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Ruth stated that only death would separate her and her mother-in-law, and she would make any sacrifice. No longer a worshiper of Chemosh, the chief Moabite god, Ruth makes a vow to the covenant Lord. Ruth set no limit of punishment if she would break her oath. Her commitment was total. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. She would die with Naomi and be buried in Naomi's land. Ruth swears her commitment to Naomi in the name of her God and the God of Israel, the true God, the Lord. Ruth entrusts her uncertain future with the Lord. After this statement of faith, Naomi stopped deterring Ruth from joining her, and the two traveled together to Bethlehem. What faith! Your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die. This is like leaving your hometown here in Michigan and going north to Canada without a telephone, mail service, or computer to be able to communicate with your home, parents, or country. Ruth must have wondered about her family and her home life, and yet she trusted the Lord to make a new home and new friends in a new land. You and I now may live far from our hometown as Ruth did from hers, but we can also find out what life is like back home very quickly. Back then, such information took much longer, weeks or months. Would we trust in the Lord so much and in our mother-in-law to live in a strange land that they would possibly shun us? Not only was Ruth accepted in Judah, there she met Boaz, who became her kinsman redeemer. That is, Naomi would sell her husband Elimelech's land, and Boaz would buy it back from her. After Ruth was married to Boaz, she became an ancestor of David and a link in the promised line of the Messiah. In a similar way, Jesus became our kinsman redeemer. He brought us back to be redeemed with his precious blood. While Naomi's bitterness was distrustful and full of self-pity, the Lord brought tremendous blessings to her and comfort to her because of Ruth. The Lord certainly was faithful to Ruth, for he fulfilled his commitment and promise that he made by sacrificing his blood and rising again. He always remains faithful to his promises. When times become difficult, it is tempting to forsake God and not to be faithful to our commitment. People make many promises which they will never be able to keep, but God remains faithful to every one of his promises. So which God will we worship? Just any God? The God of our parents or the Lord Jesus Christ? Through Christ's help, we can promise like Ruth that your God will be my God. Now to the King, immortal, invisible, only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. 1 Timothy 1:17. We join together in saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Jesus Christ, we have gathered here as members of your church to join hearts in confessing our faith in you. We believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. We believe also that you became a man, that as our substitute you might suffer, bleed, and die for our sins. As we look to the future, we ask that you make us steadfast and true in confessing our faith to others. Let not the unbelief and ridicule with which many people respond to your name and salvation discourage us from testifying to our faith and declaring our love for you. May we never be ashamed of you or in any way denying you. Looking back at the past, we must admit that we have at times failed in our mission as with your witnesses. Our many sins have, in their own way, fallen barriers to confessing your name to others. Moments of doubt have robbed our testimony of vitality and conviction. There have been times when our lack of knowledge concerning your word has been a hindrance to testifying to the truth. There have been occasions when the Holy Spirit threw the door wide open to us, giving us splendid opportunities to confess you to others, but we remained silent. There were times we were timid when we should have been bold, or were filled with fear instead of confidence. Dear Savior, do not hold these failures against us. Do not deny us before our Father in heaven. Forgive our sins and through the Spirit supply what we need to make us your bold, efficient, faithful witnesses there to the world. By the Spirit whom you have given us, establish, strengthen, and keep us in the true faith. All these things we ask to the praise and honor of your name, the only name under heaven, given to men, whereby we may be saved. Amen. We join together in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever and ever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We conclude our service with a closing hymn, Now the Hour of Worship, or hymn 330. picnic that was typically the third Sunday in July will not be held this year because of the coronavirus, and we hope to have it again next year. The flowers on the altar are given by Annette Persha in honor of Independence Day and to remember her husband John's birthday. We wish Kay Mars a blessed birthday this week, and I wish all of you that you would be faithful to your commitment that your God is your Lord.